Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Mr. Boswell, can we have our invocation, please?
If we can bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this season that you have given us to worship you, and thank you for this season for the greatest gifts ever been given. Dear God, thank you for the blessings you've given me throughout the year and for the opportunity to represent the people here of Alamance County. And God, be with the soldiers overseas as they're away from family. Protect them, put your wings over them and protect them and keep them from all harm. And dear God, we ask that you protect their families and be with them during the time of separation. And be with us tonight as we make decisions on the county business. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. First thing on our agenda tonight is public comments. Ann Robbins. Thank you. My name is Ann Robbins, and I live at 312 North 9th Street in Mebane. I was real disappointed that I was not contacted when you were going on the tour that you promised me. I understand you all had a fun trip, informative trip. And also, I do not understand, after agreeing to a consensus at the ACC meeting of November the 9th, that you changed your mind. A consensus is a general agreement held by all or most. And I don't understand that we have agreed to pay for the new survey and redrawn line, that you're giving up the tax money that you've been getting from us for the last 31 years without any complaints. I've been enjoying your seats on the board that we have voted you in, and believe it or not, Orange County is for us and giving up the tax revenue in order to have this line redrawn at no expense to you or to them. As you may or may not know, there's been several counties in North Carolina that has had the line changed. So tonight I'm asking you to do the right thing and vote to have the line surveyed and redrawn and keep us in Alamance County and make this the best Christmas ever. And I do have some things for you tonight that I've come up with as far as markers and things that might be of interest to you. I have something of the Mebane Cemetery, and it is showing the map of the cemetery, and it is showing the line, and you can see North and South 9th Street. The picture of the cemetery, and it says the location. This cemetery is actually mostly in Alamance County, immediately south of Highway US 70 and the Southern Railroad tracks on the eastern side of Mebane, adjoining the Mebane Congregational Christian Church grounds. And it does have the coordinates on that. I'll give you that. And also, I went to the Register of Deeds here in Graham, and I got this. It's a subdivision of land known as Thompson Heights, the property of Mebane Real Estate and Trust Company. And it's it doesn't show where the line actually is, but it comes the North 9th Street, and it does have our plots on here. And it says the state of North Carolina, Alamance County. Lewis H. Holt, County Surveyor, Alamance County, personally appeared before me this day and being duly sworn, says the foregoing plat is in all aspects correct and that the same was prepared from an actual survey made July the 11th through the 17th and July the 11th through the 13th, 1917, and that the variations of the magnetic are correct. Let the same with this certificate be recorded. Witness my hand and seal this 27th day of July, 1917. It was filed for registration at 2 o'clock p.m. January the 27th, 1917, and registered in the Office of the Register of Deeds for Alamance County in Plat Book 1. Page 56 is 27th day of January 1917 by B.M. Rogers, the Register of the Deeds. I know Mason Hall has been a question, and I think you guys did go to Mason Hall on your trip. And this came out of the U.S. Library, and it shows that Benjamin Franklin Mebane was born in Orange County and now Alamance, and place of residence is Alamance County. And also, he had a successful medical practice at Mason Hall. He was a Democrat representative for Alamance County General Assembly, 1879 to 1880. And I also have a colored picture. I did not make you all copies of this, but you're welcome to look at it, of the chimneys that are still standing on Leveland Road of Mason Hall. Also, it has 20.8 acres. It's Mason Hall Road, Cheeks Township. And the owner now lives in Virginia. I do have the Orange County land records on that. He is paying Orange County taxes on that now, however. I do have a map, and it's showing the land that would be behind Mason Hall, now not out on the road. I've got that if you wanted to look at that. Also, I've got something on the North Carolina Post Office's 1785 to 1882. And it's showing the post office of Mason Hall, original county, Orange, final county, if changed, Alamance, first U.S. Postmaster James Mason. Date started April the 4th, 1809. They discontinued February the 2nd, 1856. And I also have a book here. You can tell it's old. The Alamance Sequential Centennial Magazine. It does have a map, and it shows Orange County and Alamance County. And they do have some state historical markers in Alamance County. And it is showing here G38, and it's showing it in Alamance County. That is for the Bingham School. The academy under William J. Bingham moved from Hillsborough in 1845, removed to Mebane in 1865, stood near this spot. It's also showing G34, which is the trading path, and that is inside Alamance County. And G54 is where Alexander Mebane, it's showing it's in Alamance County, but maybe right on the line. And he was a Brigadier General of North Carolina Militia, member House of Commons, Convention 1788, 1789 in U.S. Congress. His home stood nearby. I can remember when that house was there. It was a huge two-story house. It's about where King Tire or the liquor store is now. But I don't have copies of that, but you're welcome to look at that also. And may I give you these now?
Sure.
And like I say, these things you can look at, but I don't have copies, and I'd like to have these back.
Okay. I have to look in there.
Letter.
I have to need it.
Just.
A question.
Mm-hmm.
Is that liquor store showing there? Is that in Orange County or Alamance County?
It's in Orange County, but according to where this paper says, it would be in Alamance County according to these papers.
Okay, thank you, Anne.
Mm-hmm.
Thank
you.
Okay, Mr. Green.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
I think regardless of the outcome of this, Anne's going to be able to put on a history lesson on Mebane.
No doubt.
She's done her research. Most of you visited the county line last week and looking for the monuments that were described in the original 1849 layout. And there was one place that hadn't come up, and that's Fawcett Mill. Fawcett Mill is out on Saddle Club Road. It's owned by Steve Beckner. And I went out there and got Steve to meet me and went to the old home place of the Fawcett House, the cabin. He's actually restored it. And we went west down a hill and did find the spring. And a quarter of a mile, or roughly, we didn't mark it out exactly from there, is the back of Mill Creek, which would substantiate that boundary, which is the one immediately before Mason Hall. The Mason Hall and a quarter mile below that, I think these pretty much substantiate each other. Mr. Sutton called me last Saturday, and I thank you for that, sir. I really appreciate that. We had, I think, a great conversation. We talked, and I wish we'd been doing this all along, exchanging some information, because I think we know some things that would have helped in doing this line and doing this research. I think we have some more things that we could do. One thing I wasn't clear on is the last meeting, it was suggested we go ahead and dot the geodetic line and then make changes. If you adopt the line, then we're going to have to go to the General Assembly and get that blessed. And if we have to come back and make changes, then that will have to be blessed. It looks like that's a little redundant or a little, doesn't make sense. I think we should go ahead and incorporate the changes that you all deem appropriate and go ahead and ask for it all at one time. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. And we'll let Mr. Aubrey address that.
Okay.
Ed Shoup.
I don't think he can with no papers, man. I got them, though.
I'm sure.
I got them. I think you can logically see that there's a lot, and I wish I could say the word ambiguity and get it out with no teeth. But anyway, that's close, you know what I mean. About did the new geodetic line actually reflect the historical line? And I think that's shaky at best, and I don't think from what we heard from the state, they went with what happened in 69. I don't think they actually went back and did a whole bunch of research on this thing. So I think you have enough to, I don't know what Mr. Albright's going to come up with, but I'm dreading it. so he comes up with some stuff. But I think you have enough to go and vote this thing, and I think you have enough to defend either one of those options before the General Assembly because of this fact of all these little, well, this looks this way and this looks that way. I think it would hold up the General Assembly. Mr. Albright said the other meeting, what were you going to use to justify doing this? And I think Nevin has provided ample justification. Thank you.
Mr. Childers.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. Hey.
Hopefully this will be the last speaker on the county line.
It won't.
Merry Christmas, Emmy. The first thing I guess I will say, because it's not incorporated into my one-page presentation, but with respect to the people, Eddie Hsu and Ann Rice and the other gentlemen that are contending the county line is, you know, the points that they've supposedly discovered or show a different version. I said, I guess in respect to them, they should produce a valid survey done by a qualified surveyor to really prove out those points. Certainly the USGS line, that USGS people that did all of the on-the-ground research, historical research and everything else, and the NCGS, as you probably supposedly found out in that trip on Thursday, really substantiated a lot of that work. And a lot of these issues, I think, have been answered by those surveyors. But anyway, I just hope that the issue will be resolved here this evening. In 2008, the counties asked NCGS to locate the historical legal line, county line. The state did that, but the line's location did not please everyone along it, who mostly had been satisfied with the county they had been paying taxes to. Faced being brought back into their historical county. If you look at a solution to this issue from an equality and fairness viewpoint, then letting everyone along the line choose their own county would have been the best one, because many people have been blindsided by the location of the county line. Most residents and prospective buyers were not informed by their real estate agent, closing attorney, or even the counties that their legal location might be in question. The counties knew in 1996 that the location of the county line was best represented by the USGS, but only 9th Street residents were informed by letter that their taxing designation may not be their legal location. The let everyone choose their own county solution was never practical because it forced a severe financial burden on county taxpayers for resurvey, as well as other practical problems such as islands of one county within another and possible emergency services confusion. From there, the debate expanded to arbitrary options proposed by Orange County. They included only giving some residents their county of choice, as well as bestowing on Mill Creek developers the right to choose the county for all of its residents, even if that meant forcing people to move against their will who had always been historically located in Orange County. This solution, in effect, bestowed special rights on some while taking rights from others. To add some icing to these options, Mill Creek developers and 9th Street residents offered to pay for a resurvey of their property. Unfortunately, the option of paying for a resurvey, assuming other residents could afford to do so, was not extended to all residents along the line. Recently, Mr. Hsu attempted to cast some doubt on the validity of the investigation and survey work done by professional surveyors at the USGS and our state's NCGS, and I have yet to see credible evidence that supports Mr. Hsu's research. And I hope that the field trip, as I mentioned before, by the commissioners, which allowed NCGS's Dennis Lee to explain how the line's location was accurately determined, erased doubts about the soundness and authority of NCGS's work, which verified the work of the USGS. The tough but fair solution is to approve the NCGS-located historical line, which will eliminate charges of favoritism and special interest accommodation that most of us fault Washington politicians for. Using the historical line will also allow the county to meet its legal obligations on taxation and property listing. And I urge you to end this discussion tonight, if you will. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Walker.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Hello.
I won't bore you with a repeat of what we discussed last time. I will just state for the record that, again, the Mill Creek developers, Tanger Outlet developers, and also Stokes Development are very much interested in having their consideration to be in Alamance County. One point of reference I would like to make, and last time we were here, there was a petition presented to you that stated that 16 folks had signed wanting to stay in Orange County. Mr. Sutton, I appreciate you bringing up the question that was called, and I actually discussed that with the gentleman who brought the petition. There was only actually one family on that petition from Mill Creek, and that was the gentleman that made the presentation. So just a point of clarification for the record. Also, I will say that I dare say this, there's been more research done to find lines than Mr. Hsu. I know Ms. Childress says he hasn't seen the proof. I've sat with Mr. Hsu for several occasions and looked at the deeds he's pulled and the properties he's looked at, and there does seem to be some discrepancy. And the other thing I would point to you guys, and I'm sure you've thought about this, but just for the record, it seems curious that Orange County would be so willing to accept option 2V3 if there wasn't something to the fact that that county line probably is further east than any of us may know. They're too readily willing to accept that option, and there's a reason why, because that true line probably is much further east. So just throw that out for your consideration. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. Okay, we don't have any more public comments at this time. I'll close public comments. Mr. McKinney, this is Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation presentation. I'll get McKinney.
Good evening, Chairman Massey, and all members of the Board of Commissioners. Manager Honeycutt and Madam Clerk. As I have in the past, when I stood before you, I tried to provide you with factual information that will assist you with consideration of the item that you have before you. For tonight, I have prepared a one-sheet briefing that I would like to go over with you. Point number one is Burlington-Graham metropolitan area is eligible to receive federal funds from the Federal Transit Administration every year. You are just like 18 or 17 other locations in the state of North Carolina because of your population exceeds 50,000 persons. At this time, PART has four funding allocations for Burlington-Graham metropolitan area totaling $4.86 million for your use. I'll briefly explain those. $1.493 million is a stimulus grant, requires no match. There is a grant from Federal Transit last year in '09 that totals $1.32 million. The current year is a grant that totals $1.406 million. And then we have two smaller CMAQ grants, congestion mitigation, air quality, because parts of your county are non-attainment for air quality. And those two grants total about $611,000. And all of them except the first grant, the stimulus grant, requires a 10% local match if those funds are used for capital investment, purchase of land, development of terminals, park and ride lots, buses, et cetera, et cetera. Now, if we get into operations, the match becomes more, but there's options. So, and then the options we talk about, they all go away if certain actions are taken. So we'll just talk about the 10%. To spend these monies, this $4.86 million, we need a local match of $336,600 or participation in Parks Regional Fund through one of two local funding sources. Those two options to generate local funds are, number one, levy an annual tax, an annual license fee on vehicles registered in Alamance County in $1 increments. Or number two, levy a 5% tax on the gross receipts of vehicle rentals. So these are the only two options that's given to us by the General Assembly. We don't write the rules, we just administer them. Now, before the Park Board can hold a public hearing and consider the implementation of either of these local options in Alamance County, this Board of Commissioners must approve a resolution that gives the consent to consider either option to the Park Board. Both of these options have been implemented in other Triad counties, actually in eight of them. The local funds are necessary to leverage state and federal funds, which are in excess of $1 million per year, and I mentioned 1.3 and 1.4, and I'll tell you what I'm reading about the upcoming budget for fiscal year 11 is there's going to be about a 40% increase. So a year from now, we'll be talking about a $2 million allocation. Point number four, the current funds totaling $4.86 million may be used by part, purchase buses, build transfer stations, terminals, and other transportation-related amenities. These funds may also be used by the Alamance County Transportation Authority, that's ACT, which I believe county funds go to. That would be used to increase the elderly and disabled passenger services and or to reduce the current cost to the county, especially for your general purpose passenger fees. And I wish Dennis Williams were here in case you have any questions, but I'll try to answer any of that. Also, Elon University runs a public transportation service. They are eligible to receive these funds to match up to one half of their operating deficit. All of these funds, federal, state, and local funds, must be spent in Alamance County. The next point is that in addition to the funds that will be coming into the county, there's other incomes that will be generated, jobs that are created, and from the money saved from reduced fuel expenses by users of PART's public transportation system. For example, last year, PART users saved $1.26 million from reduced fuel expenses, just fuel alone. We have about 1,000 loyal riders every day, so that's about $1,200 or an average of about $100 per month or $1,200 per year. Money that is saved by users of public transportation, such as $1.26 million, it'll likely be spent in the county where they live. A commissioner in Davidson County recently told me that I'm glad to see that bus come back every day because I know the people are bringing it. They'll buy their groceries when they get home. And we don't stop along the way, so as they might otherwise do. And I don't mean that to be selling. That's just a fact. So, that's what he said. Thereby generating sales tax, or it might be generating income tax wherever the money is spent. For example, an 8% sales tax on $1.26 million, or the reduced that went for fuel, that generated $88,200 somewhere. And this is more than we project to generate from a tax on vehicle rentals, and it's almost as much as we'd get from a $1 annual license fee. Just for information. Part activities, what would we do? should you ask us to provide this service. We would develop a minimum of 3 park and ride lots, one in western, one in eastern, one in middle of this county. We would purchase buses for a new public transportation service between Greensboro and eastern Alamance County. We would connect with Alamance Community College. We connect with Alamance Regional Medical Center and with Elon University. This new service will also enable PART to connect with Triangle Transit Authority and provide a service to Raleigh, Durham, and Chapel Hill, providing Alamance County residents with a connection to 2 larger metropolitan areas. I might interject right here that not only have I had conversations with Triangle Transit about this possibility, and they're very much interested in. We currently have 10 vans, 15 passenger vans, that leaves this neighborhood and goes to Chapel Hill every day. So we know that there's a market for it. If this service were implemented, some of those folks would park a van and get on the bus, probably 4 or 5 of those vans, because it's just easier. It's just more convenient. In closing, let me say that Alamance County has been a member of PART since its beginning in 1998. And we had a legislated purpose to improve the delivery of transportation services to the citizens who live in the Triad region of North Carolina. To that end, the PART Board of Trustees and staff stand ready to assist you and your residents as we have assisted in other counties. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'll try.
Yeah, you made reference to Triangle. Are you separate from them, or is there any bleed over from their group in Raleigh, Chapel Hill, Durham over to yours?
Are you talking about connection-wise or right. territorial?
Well, in management or monetary flow or anything, revenue?
No.
Anything like that?
They operate under the same rules that we do. They were created by General Assembly. The only difference is they are a transit authority. Mm-hmm. We're a transportation authority. We do land use planning, a variety of other things, road planning, coordination among these 4 MPOs that we have in this area. PART is a unit of local government. It has all of the authorities of a unit of local government, including its own police force, with only 2 exceptions. One is we do not rezone land. It's a local option. And we do not levy a tax without the consent of the affected Board of Commissioners. Otherwise, it's a full unit.
I just got your newsletter today, as a matter of fact. I'm not sure when it was sent out. It went to my P.O. box. I don't check that very often. But I noticed there, under PART staff, there are 16 people listed from your position all the way down to marketing intern. Mm-hmm. Are they all based in Greensboro?
They are.
Okay. Can you tell me an estimate of the payroll for those 16 on an annual basis?
About $500,000. 4 of those are interns. So we have 12 permanent staff. We have 4 interns now. It's about $500,000.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Vaughn has a question.
Yeah. One thing I had asked for was some financials some time ago, several months ago, and still have not received that. I did receive an informational sheet. But my question to you now, where do you see this in 20 years? Where do you see PART here in Alamance County if it came in 20 years?
20 years?
Wow. Sure.
give me 5 start.
It's not a hard question.
Well, it's not that difficult. I'll give you a big picture view. I mean, 20 years is a long term. What our country did in the 40s, 1944, Congress approved an interstate system of highways for national defense. And we built 42,500 miles of roadway. And what that did was it almost put the railroads out of business. It's been a tremendous boon for the trucking industry. It has promoted certainly economic development, and it has promoted the use of the individual automobile. It has some great things, but it has one detriment to it. When I was in school in the 60s, we studied pavement design and a lot of things about the drivers and design of vehicles and roads, but there's one thing that we never studied, the availability of fuel. Now, at that time, we got our fuel from Texas and Ohio and Pennsylvania, and that's great. The problem that we have today is that 72% of our fuel comes from outside the country. It comes from foreign countries. Now, bear with me. Here's the problem. This is an opinion, a lot of facts. Every year, we Americans, good people, we spend $550 billion for fuel to other countries. Now, we talk a lot along party lines and around our parties and so forth about this stimulus package, whether it was too big or too little or whether we should have even done it at all. What we should be talking about is this $550 billion that we give someone else for their stimulus package every year. That affects our balance of trades. It affects our national security. We get 9 million barrels of oil from Saudi Arabia every day. 9 million barrels. And everybody in here knows where 16 out of 19 came from. Every American ought to be concerned with our national security. And every American ought to be doing their part to cut off the funding stream that works against America. Where are we going to be? We will have a different source of revenue, of energy. Then our problem is going to be congestion. We are on the European trend to develop a system of buses and railroads across this country because of fuel and congestion and the way that we're developing our land. If we're smart, and we are, and you hear a lot of talk about sustainable communities and livable communities, that's where we're heading.
Okay, where I was going with the question, that North Carolina is expected to reach 12 million people in 20 years.
2030.
In 2030.
Yep.
Okay. How do you think you will be able to compete with high-speed regional train service or even commuter service?
Mm-hmm.
Because I believe that's where we're going. And I know we need to look at some kind of mass transit of some type.
Absolutely. We will, well, thank you. Almost 3 million people that we will add in the next 20 years, which is about a 33% increase in what we have now, 60% of them are settling in three places. They're settling in around Charlotte, Raleigh-Durham, and here, especially in your community where you're right between a young married couple can go either way, so it opens up more job possibilities. How are we going to meet that demand? Well, mass transportation is in our future. We did a study on commuter rail, and we certainly support rail as well as the high-speed rail, but our problem in North Carolina is that we're so attached to our automobile and we're so reluctant to give them up, we can't justify a large expenditure in passenger rail. What we have to do is to develop a whole generation or two of people who are willing to share a ride with other people, and that will feed into a commuter rail that runs from Burlington to Clemens. January the 13th, please come, we will award two contracts. One includes a study in this county of developing a mass transportation system in the urban core, and the other contract will look at transit needs in our other counties that surround us in urban core, because that's where you get a lot of benefits. People who live outside the urban core and yet commute into Burlington for their jobs every day, and they do so at the greatest expense. So we start with our bus system. We can run buses a long time till people start to get acclimated to public transportation. Somewhere down the road, we will justify commuter train service as well. But we've got to start at the ground, the grassroots up.
Why do you suppose the General Assembly chose to put this on the backs of the rental car business, if you want to put it that way, or to increase taxes?
When they in 1997, when they considered local options, there must have been a dozen options that they looked at. Obviously, sin taxes was on there. They looked at a tax on parking spaces. So if you had a private parking spaces or public parking spaces, they looked at a $50 tax per parking space. Well, you can imagine all the opposition against that. After they went through all of these options, they came down to these two. One is on rental vehicles, and I'll just say, I think it's a fact that it's a pretty popular thing to do, especially in other states. So they made that one of them, and the other one was a tax on an annual license fee on registered vehicles in the county in $1 increments up to $5. It's been increased to $8 of the $1. So that's the two that they provided in 1997. Part comes along in 1998. They gave us the same two options that they'd already given to Triangle Transit.
Well, I asked the question of our county manager at our last meeting. First of all, I made the statement, and we're going to hear from Enterprise car representatives here in just a moment. I asked the question about why, not that I would support it, but why, you know, would you accept a annual budgetary appropriation from us if we felt that it was that was the way to go? And the answer was no, that y'all wouldn't be interested in that, which appears to me to be a philosophy of wanting more of a sure thing than having to come explain yourself or give your statistics. I called a friend of mine that he was out today. He and his wife had gone home. They run a resort down at Myrtle Beach, and I talked to somebody in their booking agency, a booking department, they charge a motel tax of 11. Let's say you go down there off season and you get a $100 a night room, which would be not that bad really, but that same room's 180, maybe pushing 200 in the summer. But a $100 room, for instance, if I went down there tonight, they charge 11% tax. They charge a $5 per night resort fee, Myrtle Beach resort fee. They charge a $1 city marketing fee, and if you go in on a Friday night, they charge a $10 per night weekend fee. So theoretically, you could go in on Friday night, get a $100 room, and you would pay $22 in taxes. But they'll tell you, Chamber of Commerce down there, the resort will tell you that money is going into the infrastructure needs that the tourists are actually causing. And I would like for, if you can, you said that the state has given you this option as if you really don't endorse it, but they've given you that to work with. But what could be the logic? I mean, I understand the tourist calls infrastructure needs, but where in the world does a rental car client cause a problem to where they should be penalized with a tax or assessed a fee because of their participation with their agency? Okay. What's the logic there?
Commissioner Sutton, you have trouble making connection between the hotel tax and the overnight sleeper. I have the same difficulty in making a connection between a vehicle rental tax and congestion on our roadway.
No, I don't have a problem with the Myrtle Beach fees. I understand those. I'm saying the users of those rooms have caused the infrastructure needs at Myrtle Beach in Oree County, trash removal and so forth. Okay, but for the life of me, I don't understand where anybody thinks that rental car customers are causing any of the problem.
I'll take off the first part of my comment, and I'll stand with the second part. I have difficulty making that connection, too.
Okay. Well, thank you.
We don't write the rules. We just administer them. So.
I was wondering about it. All right. Okay. Thank you, sir.
And this is nothing personal between us. This is government activity between the commissioners and a regional authority. So I hope nobody thinks this is personal. I'm not here to advocate. I'm here. I work for you, and I'm here to answer your question, just give you the information.
And singularly, I'm not speaking on behalf of our board, but singularly, you can understand my concern for the lack of logic or – if there is some logic, somebody tell me about it.
I'll give you an opinion on the other option that you have.
Okay. That's the per car tax.
That's an annual license. I've already talked about the fuel savings, impact on air quality.
keeping money
locally in America as opposed to spending it for foreign oil. We can all see benefits from that. If we take vehicles off the roadway, everybody benefits. If I want to drive my vehicle and yet there's a bus that's got 50 people on it and instead of 42 cars, I think that's an improvement to congestion. It's an improvement to safety. So I see a whole lot more benefit to an across-the-board assessment of $1 than I do on targeting one particular enterprise.
Do you think that dollar fee per car will make that person stay home one time a year versus what their usual patterns would have been had that fee not been put on there?
I don't.
See, it's hard to tell.
We did it in Randolph County. The commissioners in Randolph chose the annual license. The same discussion that you're struggling with. And since January, I've had four calls. Three of them wanted to know, what's this on my registration fee? And I told them, thank you. One of them had a little complaint and said, I don't ride the bus and never will. And what I did not say as a public employee, I did not say, but I'll tell you what I thought. You probably don't go to the library either, but it's there for you. If you ever want to ride the bus, it's a public service, and you can, and none of us know. It kind of falls in that category.
What do you think? One more question. What do you think the scenario would have been in Randolph, Asheboro, i.e. Asheboro, had it not been for the zoo? Because I'm sure that you have routes to the zoo, I understand, and I'm sure that had to be a consideration their commissioners had to look at, that it was going to bring business to their zoo.
Well, it never came up.
Never was mentioned?
The zoo never came up. It was only this summer, and I'll have to guess, August, that we started a one route. The 9 o'clock route that leaves Greensboro goes to the zoo, and we go back on a 4 o'clock route and pick some folks up. We just tried it to see, because we had some calls. It's proven out to be a good service for the zoo. As a matter of fact, there have been a few occasions when we had to send two buses from Greensboro down because of the demand. You get a group, special citizens group, or you get a school group and so forth. So that's worked out well. But it really never came up as a reason for doing it.
Did I understand you to say that the rate went up $8?
It did. The General Assembly, this past summer, it was at $5 max. House Bill 148 gives local governments three options. One is that annual license fee that went up from $5 to $8. Okay, that's one. One, it gives urban counties, this is not one of them, but it gives Forsyth and Guilford, Orange, Wake, and Durham the option to hold a half a cent sales tax referendum. And it gives all the other 94 counties a quarter of a cent referendum. And it also created the North Carolina Transit Tax Fund. That's not funded, but eventually there will be funds in the transit tax fund that local government may fill out applications and apply for. We have to have a regional transit plan. Our contract will be let January 13th, and we'll start to develop that plan. And your folks have already been contacted about that, and there's quite a bit of interest here. So we'll see where that goes. It'll be a plan. Can I back up and address a question that you talked to last time, maybe with Manager Honeycutt? We're talking about capital investments. Now, as long as we're buying things, needing a 10%, you could pay that 10% from another source other than what we're talking about. You can do that. It's only when we start, if you want part to provide services, now when we start running buses, that deficit's going to grow. Well, we're going to have a huge deficit between our grants from federal and state operating and what the actual cost is. Now, at that time, we'll need a dedicated source. It all goes into one pot. And I don't think you want to match that, because that's going to be 30% match. So we're talking about 10% match right now. But if you want to do it some other way, that's an option.
A dollar per car would bring
what?
60,000.
I think we looked at
60-some thousand.
$65,000 or $70,000, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay, and 5% on the rental cars would be, what's that been projected?
About the same.
About the same.
It's about the same.
And that's at the dollar per race. That's not anymore. That's just at a dollar.
You said you're already running some vans to Chapel Hill. Is that
right? There's
10.
Got 10. Yeah.
And where are they parking now? Where are they parking?
Commissioner, I don't know. If you see one sitting around, it might be at a church. It might be at a, this is from just other communities I observed. It might be at a retail place. Some drivers take them home.
Now, are they full pretty much in the morning going to and from?
We don't lease them unless we have about 12 or 13 people signed up for the van. So it has to be pretty full. If it drops down below that, see, everybody in the van is going to pay around $50 to $60 per month to ride in the van. So if you've got 12 people paying $50, $600, we give them the keys and the gas card.
So they're paying their way to get there. That's not
they a pay their way
to them. It's
that's right. That's right. Okay. We buy the van. And then we charge them for the operating.
Okay, so when those monthly bills come through, I think it was a $10 increase from $50 to $60.
We did. We increased our, back to the bus service, we increased it about exactly $10 for a monthly pass this year.
Okay, but I just wanted to ride it one time, so it just cost me $2.
That's correct.
So you didn't increase that fare.
Cost you $2. For me, I ride for $1. Because of my age.
Oh, what is that going to be? The seniors have a...
Well, if you're my age, 60 or more, we can ride for a dollar.
They cheat you in.
I'm not going to go there.
What about young people?
It's a dollar.
A dollar up to what age?
School age.
School age. And through what college. About students, like college students?
Through college.
It's a dollar.
It's a dollar.
One way.
One way. Or half price for a month. You know, it'd be $30 for a month. Right. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, any more questions? No. I understand that Enterprise would like to make a comment at this time, and I will entertain that.
County Commissioners, thank you for having us here this evening. My name is Bob Andreo with Enterprise Rent-A-Car. I'm here tonight with Selena Garrett to discuss the opinions of Enterprise Rent-A-Car, our industry, and most importantly, the 8,700 Alamance County customers that we service here each and every year. Tonight, there's a number of important topics on the agenda. Obviously, the future of public transportation here in Alamance County, and then how that public transportation will be funded if that's the direction which the county goes. The first funding option, as we heard, is, in my opinion, a fairly nominal annual increase on vehicle licensing. And the other, we've all just heard, is a 5% increase on auto rental taxes here in Alamance County. Today, our customers pay 9.5% tax to rent a vehicle. This would increase auto rental taxes to 14.5% per day on every vehicle that we rent. You know, with that being said, we are firmly opposed to part and our industry being subject to that tax. And obviously, we'd like to discuss our position a little bit further. We are very much a local business. We are a privately held company. We employ many local residents, generate and pay millions in taxes every single year. We support fair-minded efforts to drive prosperity in our great state here. Our marketing slogan is "Pick Enterprise, we'll pick you up." I hope everybody knows that. Maybe you've seen one of our commercials a time or two. Kids see them, I have to say, no, that's not where Daddy works at that place. But we do. We pick people up where they live, where they work, each and every day. We rent to customers for a wide variety of reasons. They are having repairs done on their vehicle. They need a replacement. They need a different vehicle to complete a household project. Or maybe someone's taking a business trip. The funny thing is, many people are very, very surprised to learn that the majority of rentals that take place do not take place at airports. They take place in the local community at our home city locations. Currently, 95% of the 8,700 customers we rented to last year, were all residents of Alamance County. And of those 8,700 customers, 70% of them, or approximately 6,100 customers, they were in one of our vehicles as a result of replacing one of theirs. Or maybe involved in an accident in someone else's car. Maybe the car didn't start this morning when they turned the key. Or possibly, who knows, maybe a family member, neighbor, friend of yours who hit one of the many deer that we've all seen running around the streets this year. The bottom line is, the majority, 95% of our customers, they're not tourists. They live right here in Alamance County. They're individuals that are already experiencing an unexpected event in their life. They've been in an accident, and I'm sure that's creating some sort of financial burden and hardship on them. To increase their taxes an additional 5% to 14.5%, we just don't believe that's fair. I'm also here to say that many, many local people will also be carrying a portion of this financial burden. Our business partners within Alamance County, including our insurance, dealership, and body shop partners, but again, most importantly, the residents of Alamance County. We completed 8,700 transactions last year. So that would equate to approximately 8,300 times the residents of Alamance County would be experiencing this tax increase. Again, 9.5% to 14.5%. We're a privately held company. Jack Taylor started our company in 1957. Still owns the company today and very much an active role in our company. When he started Enterprise Rent-A-Car, his intention was never to be the largest or most profitable rental car company. It was simply to be the best and provide unmatched service. And with that unmatched service, we've realized that convenient locations are what is necessary. Today, Enterprise Rent-A-Car is within 15 minutes of 90% of the U.S. population. 15 minutes of 90% of the U.S. population. As you can imagine, many cases, some of our profit margins run fairly slim. But we're still able to provide a great product, top-notch service, at an unbelievable price. But at this point, an additional 5% tax increase, the price for our customers becomes a serious competitor to Enterprise. Many of our customers may decide that renting a vehicle will in fact be too much of a cost to them, and they'll find other means of transportation. This past year, we all know the downturn of the automobile industry, and specifically the rent car industry has suffered significant setbacks. Many companies applied for bailout money due to the impact on the economy and our business. And recently, Hertz was listed as at the top of a report by Audit Integrity as one of the 10 biggest public companies that are veering towards bankruptcy. Globally, the rent car industry is shrinking, and we're no different. This past year, we made a lot of changes, made some very, very tough decisions. Downsizing, and we've even closed a number of offices. Two of them are right here in Alamance County. We closed an office at Burlington Aviation and a second in Mebane. Over the past year, back up a second. Closing locations. Sky South, Mebane, and then not too far down the road in Davie County, just 3 months after the parts tax went into effect, we had to close the location there. We had to make a decision weighing service and convenience for our customers versus too much of a financial burden to operate a business. And unfortunately, the burden was too heavy for us to continue our business element in Davie County. We also believe that if this tax is in fact imposed, we'll actually see a decrease in overall tax revenue, and this could potentially deter future business expansion in Alamance County. First, a study was conducted by the University of North Texas that showed a $2 tax on rental cars would in fact reduce state rentals by $600,000 annually. Due to that reduction in car rentals, tax revenue for a wide variety of state needs would have declined by more than $2 million. And recently, an article was published by Smart Money Magazine ranking Charlotte, North Carolina as one of the top five least friendly tax cities in the United States. In that article, they directly referenced U-Drive, which is the Charlotte equivalent to PART. The fact is, 14.5% on tax to rent a car is way too heavy. and too much of a burden to put on a limited number of people. If it's deemed that Alamance County residents will benefit from improved public transportation, as well as the grant money received, wouldn't it be fair then all Alamance County residents pay their fair share? So we implore you that if you do move forward with public transportation or a system, that you please consider the alternative options as opposed to taxing the residents of Alamance County an additional 5% every time they're in need of a vehicle.
Question. Is it 5% or $5?
5%.
Yeah,
okay. How many rental companies in Alamance County?
Enterprise Rent-A-Car.
That's one.
We're the one and only.
We are.
And you have a slim profit margin.
Yeah, yes, unfortunately we do.
So if we go with that 5% on you folks, we're very likely going to put you out of business, and that'd be no rental cars.
I think what you'll see in Alamance County, as I mentioned, we have two locations in Alamance County, and some of you may have utilized our services before. We have one on Church Street and one on Mevin. And unfortunately, with an additional 5% increase, would the short-term picture see two enterprise locations? It's doubtful.
Well, I think I had a daughter. I have a daughter. Still have her.
That's right.
She's a poster child for your company.
Thank you.
Yeah. Please, you come and get her, and you get her back, and
great service.
Bad part is you bring her back.
Any more questions of them?
Now, are you set up in Guilford County?
Yes, we are.
And you're set up in where? Orange, or anywhere in Orange County?
We are.
Chatham?
Correct.
So you won't be 15 minutes though, from the middle of our county, will you?
Depends how this vote goes, I guess.
Just curiosity, though. Now, Guilford County, do they do the rental car?
They do.
Has it hurt your profit margins?
Our business has definitely decreased in the past several years. And I'm sure that part of it is due to the 5% tax. I can't attribute, exact numbers for you to say.
Probably has something to do with that.
Yeah, and the economy definitely had something to do with it as well. So it's like, a couple of different things. But it certainly does affect your business. I mean, if you're renting a car, wouldn't that 5% tax, I mean, maybe not you, but if you're somebody who doesn't have a large income to begin with, you're in an accident, you go to rent a car, it's 5% extra, your insurance company is going to pay a certain amount, but you're going to have to pay the amount over what your insurance max is, say $30. Are you going to decide to rent that car if it's an extra $15 a day for you? And the decision may be no. So you might not be able to get your family to...
But a lot of Greensburg people are coming in from airport or whatever to rent a car that are not really residents.
That are tourists, yeah. At the Greensboro airport...
I've done that in the past, and I never said, well, what is your tax on your car,
right.
Call and see who's got the best rate, and then you...
And unfortunately, everyone expects when traveling at an airport, there's
you
going
just expect
to be,
it to be
different
there.
Taxes, but not in the local home city market.
No, not in Alamance County.
Because I see rental cars, they need bases, and sometimes you don't really check on taxes to see where you're going to rent it.
Just the price going up.
Mr. McKinney was honest enough, and I appreciate it, too. Say that he did not appreciate the option of rental cars, but that it was just there. And I appreciate that frankness. What do you think could have been the logic with our wonderful state legislature to allow your business, free enterprise, without a play on the word, business to be taxed when you have absolutely nothing to do with the issue at hand? And a question linked to that is, of the close to 9,000 rentals in Alamance County, what percentage, even if you could, see the britches percentage, could you put to the destinations of those cars? In other words, the part will only have a fixed route, and it will only go certain times of the day, and so forth. What percentage of those close to 9,000 rentals do you think even took a trip to one of these routes that they're on versus
very small percentage. And I would say, you know, with the rental car agencies being taxed, and in some cases it's taxation without representation, you know, in the bigger cities like Charlotte and Raleigh, it's easy to tax a tourist. It's easy to tax someone who doesn't have a vote. But what you would essentially be doing here is taxing your local residents. 95% of our business, local residents. It's not tourists. But I think that that's why, you know, the rental car agency has been a target for taxes, is that it seems easy. You pass it, and
it's out of sight, out of mind.
Out of sight, right. Out of mind, absolutely.
That's exactly what they're doing.
That's exactly what it is.
Okay. No more questions. Are we supposed to vote on this tonight?
We need a direction, and we do not have a resolution in front of you to approve this evening. But what we were hoping for from this board is a direction to come back to you at our next meeting with the resolution either for the 5% on rental cars or for the per car vehicle tax and the amount that you wanted in that resolution, either between $1 and $8. You know, that's what we were kind of looking for tonight. Is this has been an issue that the board's discussed for, you know, quite a few months, and we are kind of under a deadline with PART as well to get some of the stimulus money, and if we're moving forward with Park and Ride, so we kind of need to get a direction one way or the other. Or it could be neither. You know, you could choose not to do neither, and that's a decision we need to let PART know as well.
Now, it's my understanding that PART has said that they have to have a public hearing, especially if we vote for the rental.
I think for either option, they do have to have a public hearing.
So we wouldn't ourselves, county commissioners, have to have a public hearing to tax Alamance County residents per car?
Done by resolution.
Well, I would object to that.
We can't now, if the board would like to hold a public hearing, you know, there's nothing to say that we cannot hold a public hearing. But is it required under general statute? No, it's not required. However, we can hold a public hearing if the board so chose.
Can we put it up to a vote of the people? That would be 2010.
I don't know if this is a referendum issue or not. I don't believe it is.
No.
Let me say, or is the public hearing over?
Well,
I am not going to support any kind of increase in taxes whatsoever to the citizens of Alamance County. And I want to be first to say that. When I took this appointed seat, I made that pledge, and I'm not going to vote to any increase taxes.
I'm not going to support either angle either. I'm sorry. I can't.
It may be good if that is the wish of the board, is to put that in the form of a motion and maybe to vote that either up or down.
I'll make that as a motion. I'll vote not to increase taxes and support funding PART.
To not.
Do not.
Taxes or support.
Right.
Second.
Okay.
Let me remind this board, which wasn't here then, there are none of the four to my right. Our county was the first county to opt out of building the baseball stadium. And they came down and wanted to build a baseball stadium over near Forsyth County, and they wanted about 10 to 12 counties to get in with a separate tax rate, you know, for the common good. And we had a guy there from Wachovia Bank from Winston-Salem stand there and give us the biggest sales pitch you've ever seen as to why we should support that. And we were the first county, and I made the motion, to not participate. Yeah, I think there was a team they were going to build in Minnesota or somewhere, right. And it turned out it was just a ploy to get an approval here, not saying PART's involved in this at all, and this is their angle, but they were trying to put a ploy out there to where Minnesota would say, okay, they're going to build it down there if we don't build it here, so we're going to build it here. But we opted out of that. We were the first county, and then it snowballed to where it just dissolved. And, of course, I don't think they were ever intending on building a baseball stadium here. But with all due respect to PART ridership, quotes that we see, I'm in Greensboro every day. I work over there 6 days a week. And I work in the general vicinity of the terminal out at the airport. I work up at the Oak Ridge area. And I'm sorry, somebody wrote to the Greensboro News and Record, what they never see a bus that's got anybody on it other than three or four people. And the answer back from Part was, well, you know, it depends on what time of day. Well, I'm over there all day, and I just don't see anybody on their buses but three, four, five people. I go by the main terminal there at the interstate and 68, the old 68 that goes up to the old terminal at the airport, and you see just a handful of people getting on the buses. I'm sorry. That's what I see, and I'm over there every day. So I don't know if I'm blind or what, but I don't believe I am.
Mr. McKinney, I have a question. Did you not say that we could fund it ourselves as far as, did you say that was the third option or no?
The match funds.
As long as we're spending the money, and I think we are, these grant monies that we have will be spent for capital investments, purchase of land here in the county, mm-hmm. Construction of park and ride lots, purchase of buses, share some of these funds with ACTA and Elon. As long as we're doing that, then we're definitely talking about a 10% match. And we have, in Davidson County and Surrey County, the local governments came in and paid that 10% match. Long before we ever started either a vehicle rental tax or an annual license fee. Local governments paid it, built park and ride lots. We could do the same thing here if you choose to go that route. The match on the grants that we have pending now is $336,600. It's about 8% investment. Invest 8 cents and get a dollar back.
Well, I have a motion on the floor.
I call for the question.
I have a motion on the floor to not do
either. To not do anything.
Okay.
I wish, before you talk, question, I wish there was another way we could come up with the money. I have to agree, you know, not to raise a tax. I have to agree that we can't put additional burden on the one rental car company that we have here in Alamance County and hope you stay. I can't do it. Is that, you know, do you have lobbyists in Raleigh that can help out here? Is there another way?
Which is what he just said.
Yeah. Is there another way?
Well, at this
we certainly don't have any lobbyists. we're just another agency.
Well, I would like to see another option too, myself.
Yeah. I think the park thing is working. I mean, you've already evidenced that in saying how many people are riding the vans every day to Chapel Hill. I personally think that is something we will need to look at, because the more cars you put on the road, the more roads we're going to have to build.
And the less farmland and right. green land that we're going to have.
I mean, so. The concept, the part, I'm for it, but evidently the board's not, so.
Okay, I'll call for the vote. We are voting on not to do anything.
Right.
Okay. At this time. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
All right. We're going on to the next step, which is planning board appointments. And at this time, Mr. Martin, if you come forward.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. What you have before you, you should have a memorandum in your packet. Address from myself and from Ken Walker, who's the planning board chairman, and he is here tonight as well. We had a few appointments come up this time, or openings come up on the planning board this year, particularly with the resignation of Kevin Clark, who had some personal issues that he was sorting through and had to step down, as well as Rhett Davis's term came up. He was fulfilling a a term that had been left open by Mark Danieli when he accepted a position with the county. He stepped down from the planning board, and Rhett was appointed to replace Mark. And Rhett has requested not to be reappointed. And also Jeff Slaughter, who requested not to be reappointed. Bill Griffith also was an eligible candidate this time. He was coming out of his first term, and he has expressed interest in being reappointed, and the planning board supports that. You should have in your packet, I have given you all of the applications that were considered by the planning board. And they have made three recommendations to you all tonight. There were six applications total. The three folks that were recommended by the planning board unanimously on December 10th are Jimmy Ray Cobb Jr., Albert, self-employed, and he's from Pleasant Grove Township, Albert Freeman, electrical contractor, Boone Station Township, and Randall Smith, a cattle farmer, Patterson Township. And all three of those gentlemen are here this evening, as well as the other candidates were notified that they had not been recommended by the planning board and were invited to come to the meeting tonight if they wish to address.
Would those three stand up so we will know who you are? Ray?
Ray and Albert.
Hello, Ray. I see this guy all the time. I don't know his name.
Albert
Freeman.
Freeman.
Randall
Smith.
Smith. Okay, good. Three good ones.
Okay, do I hear a motion? We accept these recommendations. Have a motion?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you for coming. Okay, the next thing on our agenda is the Mr. Leonard Hazardous Mitigation Plan.
Madam Chair and Commissioners, I stand before you tonight to request two public meetings for our Alamance County Hazardous Mitigation Plan. In June of 2001, the North Carolina General Assembly passed Senate Bill 300. Among these provisions, this bill requires that the local governments have an approved hazardous mitigation plan in order to receive state public assistance funds effective for state declared disasters after August 1st of 2002. Alamance County's plan was approved on May 2nd, 2005. Further requirements are that an additional update of this plan is due every 5 years, and Alamance County's update plan is due to the North Carolina Division of Emergency Management in September of 2010. The rough draft and update of the Hazardous Mitigation Plan has been delivered to the county's City Town Manager's Office for review. Most of the information in the plan has remained the same throughout the county and the municipalities. This updated plan for the 2010 includes the City of Graham and the City of Burlington. That is a change this year. We have requested any revisions from these municipalities to be received in our office by January 4th, 2010, so we can compile them into our hazardous mitigation plan. Per state guidelines and requirements, we must hold two public meetings for any input, revisions, or discussion. We would like to request at tonight's meeting that the County Commissioners allow us to schedule for the January 19th meeting, at which time the rough draft will be presented to the Commissioners, and a second meeting be scheduled for February 1st, 2010 meeting for plan approval. At this time, I'll entertain any questions or anything that you may have regarding the hazardous mitigation plan.
Any questions? We all pretty much know what that is.
We need to make a motion on that.
I guess we need to make a motion to put it on our agenda.
Yep. I will make a motion.
Have a motion and second. Okay, have a motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed. Thank you, Mr. Leonard.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Mr. Albright, you will come forward with your information.
All right. Talked last at our last meeting about the county line issue.
What did your tie say?
Ho, ho, ho.
You're not talking.
I have a joke I'll tell you after the meeting.
Thank you, Bernie.
Oh.
Okay. I recommended at the last meeting that they ratify the true line that the geodetic survey folks have established under 153A18. The geodetic survey, as I said before, is the arm of the state government And the state legislature is the only group of people that form county lines or can change county lines. We have since met with our friends in Orange and floated a procedure by them, which I think they're acceptable to, considering. And I'm going to, if I can get this paperclip off, I'll go over it with you tonight what I'm proposing. I'm proposing a resolution that will, for both Orange and Alamance County, we're about to adopt the geodetic survey line, tying it to the research that they've done, and also setting forth a resolution at our next meeting, which establishes a procedure for requesting the North Carolina General Assembly to change the location of the county line so that our friends in Mebane and elsewhere, if they want to change the county line, sets forth, first of all, that the proposed new line be set forth in a survey, and the geodetic survey folks have given me the magic words to put in the resolution. The survey for the change of the county line would meet these requirements. They would tie into the NC State Plain Grid Coordinate System. They would tie in, or tie into a survey line marker, or use U.S. A GPS survey technology on the NAD 83 NSRS 2007 basis. That's survey jargon. Then after that survey is prepared, it would be submitted to this board and to the Orange County Board. And if they do it on the Guilford line, the Guilford Board in those situations. At that point, both county boards then could consider a rationale for making the change in the existing line. You could talk about public health and safety reasons, natural geographic features such as lakes, rivers, ravines, canyons, or maybe a designated watershed area with the Jordan Lake rules. Maybe there's some reason that you can't put a road in and you can't get access. These are just some ideas for a criteria that I think the General Assembly would agree to, because that's the next step you have to do. Once the board agrees to make a proposed change, then the other board has to agree to that change. You have to get the legislature in Raleigh to agree to it. The only way I think you're going to do that is to have a criteria and some rational reason behind it. Then if the General Assembly decides that they want to ratify the change, they'll do it, and you can make the change. Now, I mentioned last week about the Mecklenburg-Iredale line, and I got on the internet and found a copy of the old line.
You got a copy of the new one, too?
I've got a copy of the new one on the back.
Just so happened to have
it's
it, huh?
Efficient.
How about that?
Thank you.
It's so efficient. How about that? I'm going to get one for my friends at Newcrest.
Is this the most prominent change that's out there?
This is done in 1989, the blue map, the MapQuest map. You see, it looks like a glove hanging over there on Lake Norman. And our friends in Iredale County got tired of that being in Mecklenburg County. It's surrounded by Lake Norman. So if you'll flip the map over, you'll see what happened. It all became Iredale County. It was brought into Iredale County in 1989. What they simply did was extend this line. Down here. A little orange thing on the back. But the reason I'm pointing this out to you, this is done for a logical reason, to provide service to a peninsula that was created by a lake. And I've done a little research on this. Of the county lines that have been through this, and many counties have, starting in 2010, Wake and Franklin, they matched the and adopted the NCGS line. In 2003, Robinson-Cumberland County followed the geodetic survey line.
Robinson-Cumberland?
Robinson-Cumberland.
What year was that?
2003.
Okay.
In 2003, Cabarrus and Mecklenburg, the state paid for a straight line, but they did a straight line and split some properties. In 2003, Harnett, Johnston, and in 1995, Harnett and Lee accepted a North Carolina geodetic survey line. in 2003, Duplin and Jones, Duplin, Lenore, and Onslow accepted the straight line. And going back to 1999, Iredale and the surrounding counties of Cabarrus, Mecklenburg, Alexander, Yadkin, Davie, Rowan, and Wilk got together with a geodetic survey and straightened out their lines. So the point of that listing there is to show you that the geodetic survey folks, they're the ones that the state approves. They're not a fly-by-night group of people. These are experienced surveyors. They know what they're doing. They know how to survey a piece of property. And if you adopt the line, then you have a known line from which you can deviate. And I'm certainly not going to tell the board it can't deviate. This is the board's decision to make. But what I'm saying is if you're gonna go that path, the way to do it is to adopt what the geodetic survey folks have laid out and then come up with a procedure in this resolution that we can put together for you, working with the Orange County attorney and with the Guilford County attorney, to come up with a criteria. So if people want to change, then they come before the board, they have a survey that's tied into the geodetic survey line. Because I think the legislature is going to ask you, first of all, is it tied into a known line? And secondly, why do you want to change it? Because remember, 98 other counties are going to be looking at this. And if they allow this change because somebody's not happy because they live in one county or another, they're going to have to address it 98 other times throughout the state. And maybe they'll agree to do that. But I think it's better to have criteria.
So what you're saying is if we want to go back and have all these people, the 2v3 option actually implemented, then we can do it after we adopt a straight line?
I think that's true. I think 2007, both this board, Guilford, and Orange asked the geodetic survey to come in and find the true line. And they did. They found the true line. They've done what you asked them to do. And now you can accept that and then take these citizens' comments and concerns and decide if you want to deviate and deviate from a known line. Because the question that you're going to have is, why are you moving it and where are you moving it from? In the example of Mecklenburg, it's clear why they're moving. There's no way to get to this little part of Mecklenburg County sitting out in the middle of Lake Norman unless you go about 26 miles up Highway 77 and curve back through the development. That was the only way to get to it. So it just makes sense.
The same criteria for Mill Creek. So
if that's the criteria that the board decides, yes.
Well, now I understand Mill Creek's getting, aren't they getting all the services? They're getting school buses and emergency. And so I don't think it's quite the same.
Well, that would be step two. The first resolution would be adopt the line. Second resolution would be setting forth the criteria for changing it. And you wouldn't change it just because somebody says, you know what, I don't like living in Orange County, I want to live in Alamance County. That's not a valid reason to change.
Are there any precedents other than Mecklenburg, Mecklenburg?
Iredale.
Any other precedents out there of where the geodetic was accepted and then changed for something other than the Mecklenburg-Iredale situation that you're aware of?
That's the best example I can find of a geographical problem, a lake.
I'd say that's a pretty good one.
It was a standout.
It makes a lot of sense.
And from that, you can create other criteria as to why you might run.
Madam Chair, if I could say, with respect to the NCGS line, five, please correct me if I'm wrong, we're not adopting the line. We're recognizing that that is the line. So that line does not have to be approved by the General Assembly.
That
so that is not us going and asking the General Assembly, saying we're going to adopt this. The NCGS people are saying this is a line, and we would be recognizing that is the true line, and then any deviation would come off of that. And the other issue that Clyde is talking about is the tax issue. That is an issue we do have to get resolved.
Under 105, we discussed that with our friends in Orange as well as Guilford. 105-352, there's legislation in that statute that says there is personal liability for the commissioners if property is not taxed in the county where it's located. So what we would propose would be a special bill submitted to our legislative delegation as well as with Guilford and with Orange during the transition period, because we now know where the line is, go ahead, because it's December 21st. We're not going to be able to get notices out to everybody now within time. Give us a transition period where there's no liability to any of the commissioners for property that might not be taxed in its county.
And then we can work on getting the other stuff done.
That gives you some breathing room, and we would ask the legislature to give us until January of 2011 to straighten us out.
Now, what if Orange doesn't agree with the GDA? What happens then?
Well, the line is where the line is.
I agree, yeah.
If they, I think they've really got a real burden with that. Mr. Childers, are you still here? Mr. Childers' case that he successfully prosecuted in that county in 2003 that establishes the USGS line as the county line, which almost perfectly matches the geodetic survey line. So
we would not be adopting it. We're just going to recognize it.
Recognizing the true line and in a second resolution, establishing a procedure for requesting the General Assembly to change the line. And you could lay it out for the first time, I think, in 160 years, what has to be done to change the line. And let them come to you with a survey, with the public health and safety reasons, or the geographic features, or the other reasons, the criteria for changing it.
Do you feel like the fact that somebody has paid taxes and voted and for 40 years, 50 years is point to be considered?
Well, that's a point that can be considered, but I mean, legally, and I believe Ms. Robbins has a letter from the state that says, or from the county that says, this doesn't change the county line.
I realize.
So that doesn't change the line where you pay the taxes. And in fact, that presents another problem, because under Chapter 105, even though you hadn't paid the taxes, it's still due. Mm. The county can go back and discover them up to 5 years. So you could get a double whammy if you're not careful.
There were also some other counties that made a change in the General Assembly, too, of the one you spoke of. Orange County and Chatham County. There was a boundary line between Orange and Chatham to memorialize a 1989 agreement between those two counties, which was already reflected in 2000 census. There was one for Gaston and Lincoln County, resolving their common boundary by allowing them to vary from the line established by the 1963 General Assembly to recognize historical practice.
Ms. Robbins, can you just make copies of that?
Only 27 counties out of our 100 counties have
and present them.
One of our shared county lines official. So it's about 27%. And, you know, we have four county lines. Only 27 counties out of 100 have made at least one of our shared county line, their shared county lines official, based on a geodetic survey. We have the chance to do two of ours. And we've still got our friends north of us in Caswell, but I think we can work with them and get that done. It'd be nice to have all four of them done. And if you want to deviate, I mean, that's up to the boards to convince the General Assembly, but ultimately the decision lies with the General Assembly. So this board, conceivably, the neighborhood could come forward with a survey, meeting all the requirements, meeting all your criteria, and it voted down the legislature. Could happen.
Because even if we present it like it is, they can vote it down.
They can. The legislature establishes the boundaries of the counties. They can dissolve a county. They can create new ones.
Okay.
Thank you. What is the likelihood of that ever happening, though? If consensus on both boards concerned and the legislative in both counties are okay with it, what's the likelihood of
let me just say the case that passed out to you, the Mecklenburg, that's an excellent reason to change it. And I think it goes downhill from there. If you change it just because the developer wants all of his property
understand that.
You're probably not gonna stand as good a chance as you would with a geographical situation.
My biggest point with this whole thing is we've been taking Ms. Robbins' money for 40 years as a taxpayer here. We've never said, no, you got to go over to Orange County, even though we gave her a letter at that point in time.
Well, the tax collector did, yeah, illegally.
Well, he did.
Well, he did it. That's right.
He did. And the people, problem. They see government representing what we're supposed to represent, and that's telling you the truth.
And now's our opportunity to correct that.
Eddie, I'm not going to disagree with you. If I could say this, Shue has he's really brought out a lot of stuff here, and something I saw Saturday that made me have a little change of heart, at least for 9th Street. Now, I'm not in favor of zigzagging out from Mill Creek at all. I mean, Mill Creek has in their letter, no disrespect intended, but that, you know, we don't want to split a neighborhood. Well, Mill Creek should have known that when they built it. I mean, they knew they were straddling the county line when they built it. So it's not an issue now to come up and say we don't want to split a neighborhood. I mean, surely you knew that then. And I'm not in favor of some irrational zigzags to take in people for just any reason. But, you know, I looked at an aerial Google map scenario this weekend. I don't have a computer, so I have to go everywhere to borrow them. So, and I zeroed in on the land there where Mason Hall was. And then I went due west. And they had little 1,000 feet scales down at the bottom of the map saying, you know, this far was 1,000 feet. So I looked at it and I said, well, it looks like to me it'd be about 4,000 feet. So then I called Eddie on the phone while I was sitting at the computer, and I said, look, you know, is this what you're showing? And he had a way of inputting the actual site and the actual line, and it was 3,900 and some odd feet. I mean, we were within 13 feet of my 4,000 and what he was computing. And what he was computing was coming off Google. And you subtract out a quarter of a mile from 4,000 feet, it appears, because that's what it said, one quarter of a mile west, and you're assuming it was there as we saw it when we went out on our trip. That still leaves 1,000 feet, you know, if my calculations are right, and his, that that line possibly, at least for that mark, might have been off. And not saying that it is, but I'm willing to go with the geodetic as the base, but then consider not everybody's request, because I think some are ridiculous, but I think some are reasonable, too.
Well, that's a good point. And if you look at this map I gave you, you see I printed this off this morning, this MapQuest map. Now, 2009, 20 years ago, 1989, this change was made. So this MapQuest is slightly out of date, mm-hmm. although it appears to be accurate. If you're thinking of buying Lake Norman property in Mecklenburg County, you're in for rude awakening, because that peninsula is in Iredell County. So it depends on the quality of the people that are putting the information in. The Geodetic Survey folks are certified by the state. They're a division of the North Carolina Department of Environment and Natural Resources. These guys are experienced surveyors.
Let me ask you a rhetorical question. Didn't it seem kind of odd that everything was a quarter, everything was a half, everything was a quarter? I mean, nothing was odd. And, you know, I had to think about that, you know. And so I am willing to look at people's petition to change it.
And you can certainly do that.
Yeah. And that's our right. Yeah. Right.
So what we're doing,
I agree with you.
So what we want to do tonight is just recognize that this is a line.
I would like for you to think about instructing us to prepare these resolutions. The resolution recognizing the line, the resolution that here are the procedures for changing it. And let me put those together and present them to you in your packet. Read over them and first adopt the line as they've located it, and then adopt a procedure for changing it. And then let the folks in Mevin or Mill Creek or anyone else come to you with a survey and meet the criteria.
Certainly sounds fair to me.
Yeah. I got one question for Ken. Of the 16, you evidently checked out the people that had signed the petition of Mr. Holmes.
Well, actually, the gentleman that presented the petition told me himself.
Okay, he was the only one from Mill Creek, so the 16, where were the 15?
Excuse me, can I make a point to mention? I have to contest what this gentleman said, because I've been in discussion with, I don't know, if, can I speak? I mean,
well, anyways, not really, because it's, I mean.
Well, but this is such an important point. I spoke with a gentleman a number of times who made the presentation here when he had 17 signatures from people in Mill Creek that didn't want Mill Creek making the decision for him. When he went to Orange County meeting, commissioner's meeting, after this meeting, he had 23 signatures on that petition. So if you're going to question the validity of those signatures and those people, then we need him here tonight, and he's not. He's had to go away for Christmas. That's where he went. I was hoping somebody, he would appoint somebody to come
here.
Yeah,
I was but just curious.
But if we need to contest those signatures on that
He actually spoke to me and Mr. Green.
Well, he needs to be here to answer that because that was not mentioned at all.
I have a suggestion.
Let's get on this.
Can I ask the Norman map here, all these people in this development that you see here, I'm sure there might have been one or two that didn't want to be in Iredell County. And in fact, the bill that they asked the legislature to pass, put it to a referendum of the people in that little peninsula right there. Vote on it. Decide what county you want to be. And I got local legislation to allow them to do
that. I'm going to let Mr. Walker.
So there was a local vote concerning that.
There's a big difference, though, than what Mr. Albright is presenting, and that is the cost. Whether it's Ninth Street or Mill Creek or a combination, option 2B3, there's no expenditure for anybody if a presentation is made to the legislature, and then the funds are spent after a decision is made. What's being presented tonight is we make a decision and then we spend money and then it still may not get done. So at least if option 2B3 was presented, at least you've got an up or down vote from the General Assembly before people aren't being asked to spend their funds.
That's right. We're not
supposed to spend our funds.
I'll never support that ridiculously zigzag line. In Mill Creek, I'll tell you right now, I'll never support putting Mill Creek in Alamance County when you knew good and well when you built it just a few years ago that it was Orange County. Now,
let's get back to what we need to do here, and as long as we think we can go back and get something done, because the people have said they would be willing to pay for the surveys.
Can I ask just one question?
Yes.
When he says the line, are we saying the geodetic line or are we saying the 1849 line?
The true line that the geodetic survey folks have located.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
The true line that the geodetic survey people have laid out.
But that's not the 1849 line.
That's the line that they've laid out, and they call it the true line based on their research.
But is that the 1849 line, sir?
Based on their research from the 1849 survey, the 1890 census, 1900 census, all the way up to the 1969 United States Geological Survey work, all the way up to now.
So you would recognize 1849 monuments then?
I'm saying that the geodetic survey people looked at all of those things.
Wherever we went to last week.
They went out and looked and found all the markers.
Well, we didn't go to all of them.
Just one question and I'll shut up. Did they list Mason Hall?
His
answer to the Mason Hall question specifically, because Eddie Shue's been sending all this information, all his materials to Dennis Lee. Okay, he also gave us emails to it. His specific answer was, in that case, they could not determine on the description whether it was Mason Hall itself, a building on the property, or the property itself, which is a wide variety. So there was no point to start with to determine that specific description. So they disregarded that particular one.
Which was roughly a quarter mile difference,
right.
Probably between where
as we talked about on the bus.
Now, one more math correction. You said 4,000 feet. And you said that left 1,000 feet. A quarter of a mile, I think, is 1440, 1480, something like that. So that left about 1800 maybe. That's a little bit more. That's another quarter mile in there. But so the answer to the question is no.
The answer to the question that Dennis Lee responded to Mr. Shue was on that particular case because there was no specific description of whether it was a property, one building, another building, a barn, or whatever. They could not make a starting point and make the ending point
to
match the four.
Right. It was not a reliable marker.
They don't use all the markers.
If we can go back, like they say, then we can look at that issue, Mr. Sutton. Is that not right, too? Is that what you think? We can look at that Mason issue.
Yeah, I'm going to look at all the scenarios. Yeah.
But you'd have a starting line from which you can deviate from.
Okay.
Now, I think that's a stronger argument when you're talking to 98 other counties.
Yes, ma'am.
Linda, the thing is, we are willing, like I've said before, and I have the paperwork where our people sign, we are willing to pay to have our survey, but we are not going to pay to have it surveyed and then it not be accepted.
But even if you pay it now, you're not... There's no guarantee that
that's
they will
saying.
Accept it.
Well, this,
so either way,
this board can't
either way,
it.
And there's no guarantee.
Right. We can recommend it, but we can't guarantee it.
Right.
But if you go down there with a 5-0 vote off this board, 3-0 vote off the local legislation of Dan, Alice, and Pony, it's going to be passed in Raleigh.
Oh, yeah, it will. I don't think that's a problem in Raleigh.
But I think it's got to be unanimous everywhere.
Yeah.
Okay, so at this point, what I'm... Yes, sir.
What we're asking for, and again, is direction. Is the board comfortable with the direction we're going? Because there's still a lot of work that has to be done with Orange County staff.
Okay.
You know, this has got to be joint resolutions, okay. All three of them passed by both boards. We want to make sure that you're comfortable with the process before we spend a lot of time going another route.
And actually, Guilford, there are actually three boards. Because
right.
Guilford, okay. I've been in communication with their new county attorney, and that, okay. And they're going to... I think follow the same process.
Okay.
But if you're not comfortable with it, now is the time to direct us some other direction.
We need to move forward with something.
Yeah.
This is it.
Does this sound like a good process?
Do we need a motion?
I think it would be
just a resolution. Just a consensus
a
here.
A motion to support the direction
motion
staff
support,
has taken
okay.
with respect to
I'll entertain a motion.
The county line resolution.
And I'll entertain a motion. Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. We will work on that.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. You better?
Yeah, I'm good.
Yeah. Okay, finance matters, budget amendment 62 and 63. Mr. Bass?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Good evening, and thank you, Madam Chair.
Good evening.
Mm-hmm. We actually have two budget amendments before you to put before the board tonight. The first one, is an asthma enhancing local asthma efforts. This is a $5,200 grant that we received from the Division of Public Health Chronic Disease and Injury Prevention Branch. This is for an air quality awareness initiative to reduce the incidence of asthma in Alamance County. And the activities we'll be doing is to, you've probably seen the air quality flags that fly in schools and around town. So we're going to buy some more of those flags. Community education. We're going to be having like idling signage, you know, at the schools. You know, school buses don't idle anymore. Trying to encourage parents not to idle their cars while they're waiting to pick up their children. We're going to be also putting like magnets on our environmental health vehicles, informing about the asthma prevention project. This is a community-based project. Also, our partners include the Alamance Burlington School System, Healthy Alamance, the Alamance Partnership for Children, the Pediatric Asthma Center, as well as our environmental health staff. So that's your consideration in approving that budget amendment.
Okay. Is there a motion?
I make a motion.
Okay. I have a motion. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
And our second amendment, we have received some funding at the sum of $3,684 from the Tobacco Prevention Control Branch of the Division of Public Health. And these funds are part of our implementation of the House Bill 2, which would include like community education, signage, public information to the public about the smoking in public places, which will go into effect on January the 2nd.
Okay. Do I hear a motion to accept this a budget amendment?
Under duress, I'll make the motion.
I'll second. I'm a reform smoker.
Okay. I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed.
Thank you very much.
Thank
if
you.
I may, Madam Chairman, just for one moment.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to share with you all there's an article that I put this is in North Carolina Institute of Medicine Journal, and it features Alamance County in the spotlight. I've got it pointed to you all, and it talks about our teen outreach program.
You got a thing
what page is
it? It's on page 400.
You have a little yellow thing here.
It has a tab on it.
There it is.
Did that come that way?
Ma'am, no, I actually do those by hand, and it is staticky, unfortunately. But it does point out the programs that we're doing in our health department, which include our teen outreach program, our targeted infant mortality reduction, women's health, mental health, and maternity services. And I just want to commend our staff for this recognition and to be in a prestigious journal like this instead of what we're doing. So,
thank you so much, Mr. Bass.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I appreciate your support.
Thank you
very much. Quick question. Does the health department do drug tests on its clients? Are they permitted to do so?
No, sir. We don't do drug tests.
Now, social services does drug tests, don't they? On certain clients?
Some of the work first, if they do a screening, we refer for a drug test. And yes, sir.
What's permitted, not permitted by law on that?
It's under the work first policy for the state of North Carolina, yeah. And there is some some required screening that must be done for all the first applicants. And then if they use a evidence-based tool, if they fail that screening, then we refer them for testing and follow-up. And if they don't participate in that, then their benefits are taken.
So I went in the back of the building one day, and somebody was coming out complaining, they made me take a drug test.
Well, our Horizons program also, does some drug testing. It's our on-site substance abuse for pregnant and prenatal.
But nothing in the health department requires a drug test.
Nothing.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. Babs. Next is a budget amendment number 66, DSS.
Oh, the sheriff
is
coming
over
here with us, too.
He says he's got my back.
He said he's hanging by the door tonight.
Yeah, I can see.
Don't hold your breath.
I have complete and utter trust. Before you, you have a budget amendment. This is Deanna Manning, the Family Justice Center Director. This is our Office of Violence Against Women grant that will go to the Family Justice Center, $222,874. Our grant actually is a little larger than that because we have some second year expenditures. This is just for this current budget year. As we mentioned before, we will be covering some of the infrastructure, computer and technology infrastructure needs at that building that will benefit the Fire Marshal's Office as well as the Family Justice Center to pay for the fiber optic under the ground and some other things, along with the teleconferencing for the 50B orders and the services that will serve our victims as well. And the vines, that's right, the 24-hour, 7-day-a-week 50B. It keeps them updated so that law enforcement has them at the touch of their finger on their computer, so they know if they've been amended or canceled or reinforced.
Okay. Any questions on this?
What's done out there? Sorry, I got a bunch of questions. Last week didn't have anything. What's done out there where you have countering? For instance, you might have a female take out charges against a male. And then, or there's communication, you know, if you take charges out against me, I'm going to take charges out against you. And it just gets to be bouncing off each other. And I think there's probably a lot of people that don't do what they should do, especially, you know, females, because they're worried about what the male's going to do legally. You know, I remember one time, you know, just something that I was involved in, you know, I had a little run-in with a neighbor over my son. And so, you know, he threatened me in his yard, and I went down to the police department, took out charges against him for threatening.
Yeah.
So then when I took out charges on him, he goes down there after, he didn't do it till he got the charges from me, and then he goes down there and does the same thing. So, you know, and then you wind up going to mediation, you know, and nobody gets justice, you know, it appears. So
I get a lot of times it's like, if you go down and take out charge, then the next person goes down, master won't issue charges because they figure that it's retaliation.
Really?
Yeah. Uh-huh. And that's something that masters have to weigh based on the evidence presented.
There is some legislation about if an officer arrives on the scene and both parties are involved, they have to dual arrest.
That's right. If there's any signs of physical violence, whatever, you know, somebody goes to jail.
All right. Do I hear a motion we accept this budget amendment? Motion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Thank you. Next is the consent agenda. Is everybody okay with that? Okay. Do I hear a motion? Yes, sir. Did I miss one? Oh, sorry. Sorry, Mr. Honeycutt.
I'll have to cry.
I'm in a hurry.
Feels neglected.
My feelings are very much hurt.
I'm sorry.
A couple things tonight. One is approval cancellation of our January 4, 2010 meeting. Historically, the board has canceled the first meeting of the year in January due to the holidays, and if there's a motion for that.
So moved.
Have a motion?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye. Next one to bring up, this has come up in the past week, is a discussion of Eli Whitney. After the meeting at the community center last week, staff began to relook at the cost of what the architects proposed and what we thought really needs to be done at that building. The architects were looking at a complete remodel of the building. When staff relooked at the building, we wanted to see what we could make it to be a usable facility without the full renovation. The architects proposed what approximately the cost was $464,000. This included redoing the bathrooms, dealing with ADA issues, new roof, asbestos removal, new energy efficient windows and doors, and on and on. In talking with staff, we feel like we can do the basic band-aids for much cheaper. In the estimates, what we looked at, we can make it usable. The only big thing we really have to do is the HVAC. We've looked at it just to repair the fascia board and repair the roof is approximately $22,000. Replacement of the gym floors and another $16,000. The HVAC is about $38,000. Contingency and general contractor costs are $20,000 for a total of $96,000.
Great.
That's a big difference.
Right. If agreeable to the board, we can use a $100,000 budget and begin looking at trying to get somebody in and going ahead with those renovations. And again, knowing that it's a Band-Aid, it's not a true renovation of the building, but hopefully to make it usable, that you don't have leaks in the roof, that you have heat in the building.
We can always go back in there and spend money on things that has to be done. Do we need a motion for that?
Well, I got one question, Greg.
Hold on a minute.
Okay.
How about the lease with the school? Because I know Brian had dropped that already.
We do. That's not an issue, really. We have a 6-month lease now, and the school will be more than happy.
We do have one to July.
Give a July, but yeah. I'm saying, you know, they spend $100,000.
Yeah, that's a minor situation.
Yeah, they're not an issue at all with the school system on that. But we feel like we could, a budget of $100,000. We're looking at possibly, if agreeable with the board, to start in about 4 months. We wanted to make sure we got Pleasant Grove done first, so we can get that off our table, and then after that's done, begin working on Eli Whitney.
Okay. Will you please consider tile floor for Eli?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
We will.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion at this point to...
So moved.
Second.
Move forward with that.
No,
have a motion and a second, and all in favor?
Aye.
All righty.
And I have one other minor thing. In your weekly update, you saw a memo about the chamber wanted to change the entrance signs with the new Carolina Connector sign. They have to have our approval, since it's in our right-of-way, to change that sign. Mm-hmm. And the Conventions Bureau will pay for the cost of that. It'll be about $4,000, but they need our approval to make those changes.
Do I hear a motion that we lift?
I make a motion.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed?
And Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Happy Christmas. Oh, thank you.
I'm not through. It's a consent agenda.
Great birthday was when? Yesterday?
Yes, sir.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday yesterday.
We won't sing him happy birthday.
All right.
We have cake.
Now let's get to the consent agenda. Has anybody got any questions about the consent agenda? If not, I'll entertain a motion to accept the consent agenda.
So moved.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Any announcements?
Yeah.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I think this has got to be said publicly, because I'm afraid a lot of people don't know about it. But the night that we did what we did, reelecting you as chair, in Wake County, their commissioners voted 14 times to get a chair. And the only reason they got the 3-2 vote was one of the commissioners went to the bathroom.
I know, but I knew
without
that.
Getting an excuse.
And we've heard that before.
I knew that.
Yeah.
And then when they voted for vice chair, they voted 117 times for vice chair and still didn't get it. And they had a group of veterans there and or old people, and I'm not sure they were to be recognized, who senior citizens, I should have said old, senior citizens and or veterans, and they got up and left because they just thought, you know, you ain't going to get this, and they just got up and left. So I think it says a lot about them versus us, and I just had to point that out.
I had already heard about it anyway.
Isn't that ridiculous?
It was. 10 hours. About 10 hours. That's okay. Any other announcements?
Yeah, I like to make one. I just want to let you know
that Willie Mae Kearns is having her, I'm not sure which birthday, on Christmas Eve. She does so much for the seniors in this county and continues to work so hard for them. So if you have the opportunity to wish her a happy birthday, please do so. She's a lovely lady. Thank you.
Any other announcements? If not, I hope everybody has a great Christmas.
Happy New Year.
And we are adjourned.
You and the friends first.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.